honors program for attending. So we'll just kind of maybe pass it up and down here if you have it, if you could. Just start a second column on there. And then also over on the counter, we have a little paper you can put your name on. Put your name on it for a drawing. Kevin has read some sacks along, and we're going to do a drawing on those when we're finished. So this is Kevin from Shushak, and I will just let him tell you a little bit more about himself and his business and what he has to share with us today on proper shoe wearing.
Okay. Right. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
All right. Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Thanks for having me here. My name is Kevin Coker. I'm the general manager of the Shoe Shack. I've been in the shoe business since 1978 when I was a 15-year-old working at Oakridge Sports, if anybody goes back that far. And in 2002, we opened up our own store in conjunction with the Bike Shack, so we've been doing that for the last 15 years. So, our endeavor every day, and when we do seminars like this, is to help to educate everyone on the importance of proper footwear, because all of us have our own little individual things that are different from one to another. We all have our little foot idiosyncrasies that somebody might have a high arch, somebody might have a flat arch, and someone has an arch just in between. So with the process that we use to help you figure out which foot type you are and how that correlates to the proper shoes you should wear, hopefully most of the time that translates into you having your optimum comfort and protection and try to prevent injuries and sore feet and sore legs and everything else you go along with that. So I'll be covering a lot of that information today on the foot types, the gait cycles, which is the motion of the foot as you walk from heel to toe. And then at the end of everything, we'll talk about shoes in between. And at the end, I'll hold an open forum. I'll be glad to answer any questions you may have in regard to problems you have with your feet or your legs or just general comfort or questions about shoes, okay? Right, awesome. First thing I like is maybe just a couple of volunteers so I can get your footprint. That's my ugly foot right here. I'll see if I get a couple more, I can show you the variety and the variables go from one foot to another. Anybody want to slip a shoe off? Okay. That's good. Hopefully I can hit an A so you get all three foot types. Okay, go ahead and stand over here. Thank you so much. I'm going to take your shoe off, so it looks like you're ready to go. Just want to be fine today. Well, if you come in for some shoes, or when you come in, it's been positive to do it. We'll print both feet because certainly there are variables from right to left, too, as far as your feet are concerned. Well, look at that. We have two high arches and one medium high arch, but that's okay. I'll kind of go through that with you guys. But as you can see, they are all different. Almost like a thumbprint, the footprint is different for everybody. You know, this arch is relatively high with a lot of curvature to the foot. Mine has a little more surface contact and some pressure points. And this one's kind of in between. Sometimes with the flat arch, it's all filled in here. And everyone has different requirements for their shoes. But so we'll always give you a footprint so you can see what we're working with. All right, so anyway, the three basic foot types and gait cycles go together. So we'll start with the idea is that what we always want to do is bring the foot into a neutral position, so that it doesn't overpronate or have too much inward rotation, or that it doesn't supinate or have too much outward rotation. So typically, a person with a high arch is going to have a more rigid foot type, and that foot wants to stay on the outside edge of the foot. So it will tend to be, if you, I don't know if you can see this now, but instead of being neutral, it'll want to go this way. And then the people with the flatter arches will want to generally go into the inside here. So when we have those two extremes, the high arch or the flat arch, we'll utilize the footwear to bring them back to the center. Because when we're neutralized, that's when we bear weight and walk most efficiently. Okay? So now gait cycles, The foot types, high arch, too much outside rotation, flat arch, too much inside rotation. Medium arch is usually right where it's supposed to be. So then when you think about how the foot types translate into the gait cycle, well, a gait cycle is your walking motion. It's usually, in walking especially, it's a three-phase motion. Is you have your heel strike, which is your impact phase, then you have your mid stance, which is your weight-bearing phase, and then your toe-off, which is propulsion. So all of those have special requirements as far as your shoes. We want the shoe to stabilize it, and to cushion, and to guide and push off efficiently. Make sense? Yeah, okay. So it's basic biomechanics. Anybody take biomechanics in school? Well, it's all about the body in motion and how to efficiently reduce shock and impact and make it as neutral as possible. Okay. So I guess I lied a little bit there at the intro. Anybody have questions about the foot types? So I will field a few questions. Okay. So just to check to see if you're listening. What does a high arch do? Anybody want to tell me what a high arch does? Does it
outside.
To the outside. Remember what that was called? Somebody said it. Supination, yes, okay. What about the flat arch? Excuse me? Yep, rolling inside, and that's called pronation, yeah. Now, the thing to remember is that pronation is, in regard to footwear, it's kind of an overused terminology because everybody will pronate to a degree. It's kind of a natural thing when you strike the heel, most people will start to, your first heel strike, you supinate a little bit on the outside of the heel. Most of you probably wear off the outside edge of your heel with your shoes. Do you notice that? Your heel gets worn down out here quite often. Okay. But then when you start to, pronation is the body's natural ability to absorb shock. So you'll hit the ground and you'll start to rotate, and the hip and the knee and the ankle all start to absorb, act like a shock absorber, and start to pronate a little bit. It's only when there's not enough pronation or there's too much pronation that it really becomes a problem and you need to have some correction, so to speak. So, just keep that in mind. That's very important because sometimes people think they're an overpronator when you're really not. You just have the right amount of pronation. So. And again, when you come by, we'll do a full foot analysis for you, gait analysis, and also check some things out, which I'll go into next, is talking about cue angles and subtalar rotations. And so, you didn't know it's going to be a physiology class today. Okay. All right. So, does anyone remember what the gait cycle, what the three phases of the gait cycle are? We had the heel strike, which is the impact phase, and then the mid stance, which is the weight bearing phase, and then toe off is propulsion. We just walk, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you don't think about that. You just put your feet one in front of the other, and you go and you walk. But it's when things start to hurt that you really start to think about it. So if you get sore heels or sore arches, tendons and things like that, your back and legs. So these are the things that can help to make it better. About the biomechanics. Okay, so now, anyone know what it means to be knock-kneed or bow-legged? Seen that before? Okay, well, that's the cue angle. So that's the other thing that you need to look at is not only what your foot type is as far as the arch being flat and rotating in, or the arch being high rotating out, or somewhere in between, but also what's the alignment from the hip to the knee to the ankle? Because everyone is different there too. We all have our own little intricacies that are different from one to another. So the way that we check that for you, and if you ever want to check it yourself or check someone in your family, is just have them do a simple little knee bend and have your feet flat on the floor and you just do a squat. Now mine, I have a pretty neutral positioning. Everything is straight and in a good line there. But now some people, when they do that, they'll go like this. And the knees really drop in. Seen that before? Some people look like they kind of walk like that. That's called an inverted cue angle. And that's, what do you think that does when it's going inside this neutral line? Would that be pronation or supination? Pronation, yes. Yeah, so that's something that can help be stabilized by your shoes and our supports too. And then the other thing, so the Q angle is the knee rotation, either in, out, which would be bow-legged like a cowboy. I'm sorry, I shouldn't say that, but that's, you know, riding on the saddle with a big belt buckle. And then the other thing is the ankle joint or the subtalar joint, and that one will sometimes do this or this. And so again, it's just bringing it back to the center. Try to get the close to perfect as possible alignment so that you're just walking nice and neutral through there. Okay? All right, so the Q angle, is that the ankles or the knees?
Knees,
yes. Yep. And then the subtalar joint is the ankle. Yep, okay. So, good things to keep in mind when you're thinking about discomforts you have. There's many foot conditions that can come from variables in those alignments, such as plantar fasciitis. Maybe some of you have had that, a common ailment. Achilles tendonitis, posterior tibial tendonitis, and peroneal tendonitis. All the bad itises that really can make your work day and your exercise a little more uncomfortable than they should be. So we can talk about that a little later too. All right, so any questions on the foot types, the gait cycle, the alignment things there? Anybody having any problems with those issues? No? Okay. We'll talk about that again more at the end. Okay, so now those are the basics, foot type, alignment, and all that good stuff. Now, how do the shoes match up to help with those situations? Okay. So every shoe basically is made up of a certain group of components and characteristics that they have. The basic features of the shoes are that they have an upper, which is the top part of the shoe, and that's the part that gives you breathability, support, coverage, and protection. Then you have the midsole. The midsole is the part that offers cushioning and control, guidance, support. And then the outsole is the part that offers you traction and durability, primarily anyway. There could be some things that come in and play into that a little differently, but those are the basic ones. So the upper, the midsole, and the outsole. Now there can be, I did bring a couple of other shoes. Your primary differences in your uppers are mostly nylon mesh, which would be lightweight, extremely breathable, and real light and soft and comfy next to the foot. And then your other option, generally speaking, is leather. And the benefits of leather can be it's more impervious to weather conditions, so you don't get water through them as easily, you don't get wind through them as easily, and they can be a little tougher, less likely to tear, and things like that, pretty much. Okay. But otherwise, the differences in the midsole and the outsoles are pretty much the same, from leather shoes to mesh shoes. So those are your upper materials, basic differences there. Sometimes there are combinations of leather and mesh, if you need the best of both worlds. But the real key is the midsole. The midsole is the part of the shoe, the component of the shoe that does most of the work. So when we're walking or running or working or standing, you're multiplying your body weight. Matter of fact, when you run, you're increasing your body weight anywhere from 3.5 to 5 times at impact forces. So you need to have something that's going to absorb that impact. So every company has some kind of a special foam or a special gel, maybe you've heard of, different things like that, that are designed to decrease the impact forces or offer cushioning. I never want anyone to get really hung up on what the companies try to promote as their cushioning system being the best and that type of thing, because they're all really good. It really comes down to just finding one that fits your foot well and feels comfortable. But as long as you have the cushioning, there is one company that is offering a maximum sole shoe, Hoka. I brought a few of these today. And they're extremely lightweight, and that's a maximum cushioned shoe. It's not anything like the Skechers shoes that you've seen in the past, because those were a huge problem. They had lawsuits against them and everything. But this is a shoe that was pioneered in the ultra-marathon circuit where they're running 100-mile races, and you need a lot of protection. Running 100 miles, yeah, that's a long way. So. But anyway, so the midsoles have to absorb the impact. Now, they also have to stabilize. So if you look at, these shoes from the side here, I mean, they all, even though they're different colors, they kind of look the same. But when we switch them around, you'll see there's some differences. Hopefully you can see that. Notice how this particular shoe has three different colors here. One, two, three. So this particular shoe, these midsoles are different densities, or what they call a durometer measurement. So this very firm, slightly firm, and very soft. So with that being on the inside, the person with the flat arch and the inverted Q angle, who wants to go this way, those being different durometers or firmnesses help to rotate that foot back to the center. So that's how that shoe is made to be different. And I'll pass that around. You can kind of just take your thumb and press on those foams and feel the difference in the density.
If you just go right here and press that, and then press the dark gray, and that
way you feel the firm, medium, and soft. So that's how we work to stabilize the people with the higher arch or the lower arches, so that they don't rotate to the inside quite so much. Then you have a shoe like this, where this is all the same color. And so this shoe is very neutral and is designed for a person with a higher arch that wants to hit out here. And since these are the same densities in the midsole, we can allow this person to strike out here and rotate in to a neutral position and not be forcing them too far that way. Just allowing them to neutralize naturally. You can feel those densities, how they're the same. And then the good in-betweener has just a little small pronation, because remember I said pronation is natural. So with natural pronation, we just want to stabilize it a little bit. So we have a smaller medial post is what that's called when it's a different density on the medial aspect of the foot instead of the lateral. That helps to keep the foot from just controlling that pronation enough so it rotates and lands about neutral on that too. Okay. I won't spend a lot of time talking about the outsole of the shoe unless I didn't really ask you, Sue, but do you have requirements for non-slip soles in the workplace? Or can you wear whatever?
No, they do. I'm required to wear them.
Okay, all right. So some of these features are available with non-slip soles. The sad part is that the shoes that have non-slip soles, they haven't taken them to this level of control and support, unfortunately. I really wish that they would, but because so many people do have to wear them. But I do have some shoes, like for instance this one and some others that we can order in that are non-slip soles. Okay, just so you know, because if we're looking for work shoes, I can get you comfortable work shoes. But also a lot of this would be for your after work fitness activities. When you're walking, or if you're running, or if you're working on the treadmill or the elliptical machine, or you're doing a class. You know, any of those types of things, it's important to know what your foot needs are and how the footwear can help you to do those comfortably and stay healthy. So the other thing to keep in mind too is that shoes are made on a certain type of last. And the last is just the shape, or it's a foot form that the shoes are made around. And again, when I showed you the footprints, these are all different shapes. Even though these three are similar, but they are, we do have some contrast. We don't have a flat arch there. But if you look at the bottom of shoes, can see that they have different shapes. And this is where we try to correlate the footprint to match the base of the shoe. Because a person with a flat arch would certainly do better with something that has a little less curve out of here, because that matches more of the high arch print. I'll show you that next to it here. Forgive me, because I forgot to bring the straight lasted shoe to show you the difference there. But you can see how this curve kind of matches the curve there. This comes in, starts the heel, comes up this way through here, that cavity, and how this shoe has a similar cavity there. You can tell that. Okay. So we want to have a good, so when the foot sits down on the platform, it has a natural, comfortable feel to it. So for instance, a person with a flat arch, if they put on a shoe like this, what's going to happen is they're going to have a lot of overhang here, because their foot is going to bottom out over the top of this sole. So we want to try to give it a wider base. You can see it on this one. I guess I did bring it. So much wider the base is through the midfoot there. So that gives them a better platform to rest on. Maybe you've tried on shoes before and you think, oh, the arch feels like it's in the wrong spot, something like that. So that's why that happens, is because you just don't know a lot of times what shoe you really need to be putting on to match your foot shape. So the last, or the shape of the shoe, is very important so that we can match it up with your foot, your individual foot type. Throwing a lot at you. I don't expect you to remember everything. You just come see me and I'll remember it for you. Okay. Let me take a quick look at my notes and take care of my throat here. I haven't had the pleasure to do one of these for a while, so I feel a little out of practice. Any questions on what we just covered here as far as the upper of the shoe, the midsoles of the shoe, the anything?
I have a question.
Okay.
So the soles on them, they all seem so bulky.
These?
Yeah.
Okay. Well,
so, I mean, can you get shoes that don't have as thick of a sole on them that are, like, equally comfortable? Comparable?
Sometimes. Depends on the composition of the midsole. So we have, I didn't bring, like, fitness shoes today, but we have shoes that are more in what's called a minimalism category, and they offer less shoe, so a lot of protection. And so, therefore, yeah, I kind of brought the shoes that were showing the maximum protection type things so you could really see the differences. But if you have a foot type that's conducive to doing that, if you don't have any major foot issues, no discomforts that are just really plaguing you and affecting your daily routine, then we can maybe think about doing a little less shoe. And when you do put them on, they're extremely lightweight. Look how lightweight that shoe is. So while they're substantial in their components, they're not heavy by any means. Yeah. So.
See a lot of person wearing this.
Yeah. Yeah.
What
people
about,
on their feet.
What about heels first?
Okay. Yeah. So heel spurs. You know what we do for heel spurs is we always need to make sure that we get the heel on the impact phase to be cushioned and be stabilized to get rid of the shearing. So again, that's where it comes into the foot type, the footprint, the shoe last, the cushioning, get the foot cushioned, get it stable so that it has the least amount of, trying to reduce the amount of situations that create more discomfort. We don't want to exacerbate the problem, we want to try to make it better. So if you had heel spurs and you had a shoe that was allowing you not providing you enough cushion, so instead of this, it's this, and then instead of here like this, it's like that, then it gets irritated more. So that's why you want to always go through the process here to get the foot the right shoe.
So if you have a shoe that's So it's not one shoe particularly for that problem?
Exactly.
It's all about your footprint?
Yes. Because your friends are always going to say to you, and they mean the best, I'll go get Asics, they're the best shoe. And get the gel Nimbus, that's what I wear, okay? And maybe that is good for them, but your foot is probably completely different. And I have so many people come in and say, oh, I got these because my friend told me to, and I don't like them. And then we find out, well, it's because it's a completely different foot type. You'll do a lot better in this other type of shoe. Yeah, so anyone who makes a claim saying that this shoe is great for plantar fasciitis, you really can't say it. It could be if it's the right foot type, but it can't be a blanket statement like that. It can have maybe some features to help with it if you have the corresponding foot that would work well with it. Can I answer it for you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Hold some thoughts and questions. I'm going to move into now how to determine that your shoe fits properly. In case you go home later and you're looking at the shoes you have and think about how they're actually fitting you, okay? All right. So there's four typical things you want to look for in how your shoe fits. Proper toe room in the front, the alignment of the ball of your foot at the what's called the metatarsal flex path of the shoe, how it feels through your arch, and how snugly it fits your heel. All right, so most people tend to wear the shoes too short, and that's why we see so many folks that come in that have ingrown toenails, black toenails, pinched nerves, bunions, many things that, neuromas, stuff like that, that are sometimes caused by genetics, but many other times simply because of ill-fitting footwear, and that can really be remedied by just a proper fit. So things you want to look for, some standards anyway, when you think about that, is that you should always try to have about a thumbnail spacing from your longest toe. Now sometimes people have what's called a Morton's toe, where your, this will work well, where your second toe is longer than your first one. Anybody have that here that you know you do? Okay. You know, there's an old saying people with a longer second toe are very intelligent. So look to her for questions you have. But anyway, so whichever toe is your longest one, your first or your second, you want to look to make sure that if this is the end of the shoe and these are your toes, they need to have room to do this, because remember in the gait cycle, what that phase is where you push off, that's the propulsion phase, where your metaphalangeal joints, sorry, I'm just going to throw that word out occasionally, they expand to push you forward. And so if they don't have enough room, it's just jam, 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 and they get all messed up. So there's three types of toe you can work with. Minimum, which is, well, it's not our favorite one, but some people like to push you snug and try to give you some room. So a minimum is like a little bit in front of where you generally have the seam work. A standard toe spacing would be at the seam work, and maximum would be a little bit behind. So just think about when you put, and you have to be standing up to check that too, because if you're sitting down, your foot isn't functional, it's not bearing weight, it's not expanding. So take a look, make sure your heels, I always have people kick their heels back, because if you don't have your heel all the way back, and then when you check it, you know, it should be not jammed up here near the end of the shoe. There's probably someone in here that's thinking, I wear my shoes short, my toes are fine. Anybody thinking that? Okay, good. Mm-hmm. Sometimes that happens. All right. Okay, so then give yourself some toe room. The old adage is to give yourself as much toe room as you can without feeling big back here in the heel. We'll get back to the heel. So give toe room. And then your big toe joint right here, the ball of the foot, that's your first metatarsal over here to your fifth. That should line up where the shoe usually bends. Oh, and you want to keep an eye on where shoes bend. You don't want shoes that are, unless you're getting minimalism shoes, but they shouldn't be all bendy. They should have some structure to them. Good. certain things that we do sell the real flexible shoes for, but generally not for foot problems. So make sure that the ball of your foot is lined up, usually where that first, where those first eyelets start to line up there, it'll be in that general area. And then the other thing is you want to make sure that you're resting on the midsole unit here and not hanging over the edges. So if you see that your foot is doing one of these numbers where it's just rolling off the edge, you know what I'm saying? Then the base of the shoe, if I can see if it's doing something along those lines, or if your big toe is hanging over the edge of the midsole, it doesn't fit right. So you should have the sole unit of the shoe should be outside of your big toe and outside of your outside edge of your foot too, so that it's providing stability and not have an overhang one way or the other. That makes sense, right? Yeah. Okay. And then we talked about your arch. Well, when you have a high arch or a flat arch, it directly affects the height of your instep, which is the top of your foot. And when you're putting your shoes on, if you have a high arch, you generally have a high instep also. And the higher the instep, you may notice sometimes how your foot is, you have a hard time getting it in there, or it's you can't get the shoes laced up over the top adequately. We'll be talking about that a little bit more or something. So I'm going to give you some guidelines real quick. So that when you put a shoe on, if you take two of your fingers, your index and your middle finger, and place them between the eyelets here, you should have about two fingers spacing between them. In so doing, then you're getting the right amount of fit through the saddle that keep your foot from shifting from side to side or moving forward and back. The maximum would be 3. And the minimum is 1. Because if you start to get them too close together, then your foot will just swim around inside. And you have to keep cranking your laces up, pulling them up, trying to get your foot tight in there, but you can't because there's too much shoe and not enough foot inside. Whereas on the other end of the spectrum, if your instep is really high and the shoe is a low volume shoe, then you can't. You have too much foot and not enough shoe, and you can't get it tied up there, and it's probably going to feel too tight. But all the shoes have a varieties of volume, depth of volume in the midfoot, the toe box, and back here in the heel. Does anybody wear orthotics here? Okay. Half length or full length types?
I have three-quarter length.
Three-quarter length, yeah. So if there's inadequate depth in the heel counter, you've probably felt it before. When you put your orthotic in, it feels like you're going to walk out. So that's another thing where the depth is important, and to get the right fit to complement an orthotic. If I digress a bit, if you do wear orthotics, sometimes this happens. You have a control orthotic, something the doctor made for you to control maybe your overpronation. And then, so the doctor told you that you have a need for pronation control. And then if you just go buy yourself a shoe made for overpronation, well, what happens is that you have a strong aggressive orthotic and you have a strong aggressive shoe, and all of a sudden you are overcompensated. So the orthotic was designed to bring you to neutral, and then you add in a really stiff, heavy-duty control shoe, and instead of being neutral, you're being forced to supinate. So that's the other thing we take into consideration, is when you have an orthotic, you need the right amount of correction to work with your shoe, so as not to be overcompensated or undercompensated in that regard. Because they really, the orthotics are a great idea, and if you have custom orthotics, or if you do an over-the-counter orthotic, they can really help you with your comfort levels too. So the spacing between the eyelets, and then you should make sure that your heel, now all heels can move a little bit. You shouldn't think that it's going to lock in and just hold on to you and you won't have any movement. You're going to have some. But you don't ever want to have, if you could take your index finger and really move it around the back of your shoe, you probably need a little snugger fitting heel. And it doesn't always mean that you need a smaller size. It means that you probably need a different taper on the heel counter back here. So sometimes they can be wider, and sometimes they're more tapered in. And there are, if you just look at this, if you can see that, see how wide this one is and how narrow this one is? Can you see that? So they're gonna fit differently on people's heels because they're tapered differently in the back. So what we'll do is if you tell us it's slipping back there, then we'll try on another shoe that has the features we need to do for you, but maybe we'll get a different fitting heel. Or sometimes you put this type of heel on that's really tight and it feels too tight, like your heel's being pinched back there. We have to go a little wider. So make sure your heel's snug, that you have toe room, that your arch is comfortable, and that you have good spacing in the instep there. There are also many different lacing systems. So once the shoe is on your foot, we can customize it with a variety of lacing systems to accommodate bunions. We use a series of loops to change the way a shoe feels on your foot. And post-presentation here, I can maybe show you a couple lacing systems on your shoes if you're having some issues, how it can help you out with that. But yeah, people with bunions, people with accessory naviculars on the top of their instep where it's like a bump on the top of your foot, you sometimes have to lace around that. And it's amazing what a difference it can make. Your shoe might feel just a little off, but just by changing the lacing, it feels perfect. And we were talking about that with Sue the other day at the store. So change her lacing a little bit and got it right on. So many different lacing options to help customize the fit and feel of your shoe. Okay. So if you do everything there that I talked about today, you should go away pretty much with a very comfortable pair of shoes. And that's why I always give you a 30-day comfort guarantee, because there's always the intangibles that could possibly pop up, and I'm always glad to troubleshoot it if you're having some issues with anything, so we can make sure you're going as close to 100% comfortable as possible. So just feel free to keep that in mind. You come by with the coupon. And then the handout I gave you is just kind of a synopsis of some of the things I covered here today, just to help you via some reminders in printed form, so you can keep that in mind when you're thinking about your shoes. So I will open this up now to questions about anything that has to do with shoes or feet or that you might like to know.
You have a bunch of insoles there. When would you buy a different insole for shoes?
Okay. So mind you that sometimes folks come in and say, I'm looking for a shoe with good arch to it. Okay. Well, in the athletic realm, they don't put arches in shoes anymore because, as you saw in the prints, everybody's arches are different. So they put generic liners in here because more than likely, if you have some kind of an issue, you're gonna need more of a customized arch. So they don't build it in here per se anymore. Now, some shoes like Birkenstocks and other things, they have the built-in foot forms and you have to try them all on to find which one hits you the right spot. But as far as the athletic shoes are concerned, they don't build it into the shoes. And the other thing is that those of you who have custom-made orthotics from your podiatrist or your chiropractor or physical therapist or whomever, if you had that and the shoe had a big arch built into it inside, well then when you put your orthotic in, it's gonna rest off kilter and then that wouldn't feel right. So it needs to be a flat base in there for you to put your orthotic on. So then with that in mind, when we're visiting and talking about your needs, if you do have a need for some added arch support, maybe you've had some plantar fasciitis, maybe you have, there are four arches in the foot, your transverse, your inner longitudinal outer, and then the metatarsal. Transverse arch is one that goes across the instep. So sometimes people have some discomfort from that because the inside arch here isn't supported properly. So it could be a number of things. But just like the shoes, I have arch supports for all the different arch types as well. So we can try to cover that when we put your foot in here, it feels natural and it's lining up. And many of them are heat sensitive too, so as you wear them and you perspire into them, and your feet get warm, it helps them to mold in the shape of your feet. So I pretty much always wear some kind of an arch support, and we sell many of them. These are more of the rigid types. Now, sometimes folks don't have a need for excessive arch support, but maybe they want even more cushioning, and then these are the added cushion piece that you can put in there. This one with the top cover here that's this color, this is for diabetic feet or hypersensitive feet. Anyone here have diabetic issues or diabetes? Okay. Yeah, when you do, that foot type or that condition requires special needs for their feet as well. So, but it doesn't mean that someone who isn't diabetic can't wear this one because it's ultra soft. Really nice next to their foot. But there are many times when you have a need for extra cushion or extra arch support or the combination of both. And they can be very helpful. Any other questions?
Talk about when you go to a shoe store and you go to the basketball section or the CrossFit section or a volleyball shoe. I know there's a lot of misconception and a lot of injured feet based on it's more of a marketing ploy. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure, yeah. I mean, as far as my store, we specialize in running, walking, and fitness, and anything you need for your work environment, casual, things like that. Not casual shoes, but for casual wear with these types of shoes. But for sports, you know, a basketball shoe, you should never play basketball in a running shoe because they're made, running and walking shoes are made for forward motion. So as soon as you start to do any kind of an activity where you're going to be moving side to side, you apply plyometrics, jumping, lunging, quick movements and things like that, you're going to turn an ankle or blow your shoes out. So it's a double whammy. So not good for your feet, not good for your shoes. So that would include tennis, racquetball, volleyball, basketball, all those types of things. And then vice versa, you don't want to wear those court shoes for running and walking and that type of thing. I mean, typically you don't want to. Some people have zero foot problems. They can wear whatever they want and they don't ever have any foot troubles, but they're the exception to the rule. They're not the norm in that regard. So. Is that what you're looking
for? Yep, that's exactly
yeah. Yeah. The reason there's such diversity in product segmentation, the categories, is that it really does make a difference on how you're, what athletics you're participating in, so that the shoes can maximize your performance, your protection, and your comfort. So, like the CrossFit shoes that we sell, they're made for box jumps and for lunges and for kickboxing and P90X and Insanity and those types of workouts. Anybody do those things? If you do that in a running shoe, you know, I have on a running shoe, and if you do this, the running shoe just wants, and the mesh just wants to let you keep going that way. Mm-hmm. Whereas I didn't bring any of the cross trainers, but they have a more stable lateral aspect to the shoe, and so when you stop, you just stay there instead of shearing, and then so you have to work even harder, and your footwear isn't complementing what you're doing. And then those shoes are made with very smooth soles, so you can work out on tile or wood or carpet and have less friction. And then less sole, so when you're jumping up on boxes, things like that, you're not catching the sole on those things and killing yourself. Or maiming, whatever would be the worst situation there. So. But yeah, you want to make sure that you're getting shoes for the activity that you're doing. And then if you're a multi-sport athlete, then sometimes that requires a couple pairs of shoes. So you can do those all safely and comfortably. Any other questions? I'll be sure. I think I can answer it.
What if you have knee problems and not foot problems?
I didn't catch the second part.
What if you have knee problems and not foot problems?
Okay, well, everything starts at the feet, but it may not fix your knee problem, but again, it's all about alignment. So I have bad knees too. I have zero foot troubles, but I have bad knees. But wearing improper shoes, if they're not properly cushioned, then that's more shock up the foot, to the ankle, to the shin, to the knee, to the hip, to the back. So again, the whole thing works together, getting the foot stabilized and absorbing the impact forces. So, will it fix a knee problem? You know, I mean, if you have a ligament tear or a cartilage tear, no, it's not going to fix that. But at least if you're wearing proper shoes, you don't have some biomechanical thing that's exacerbating the problem and making it maybe more uncomfortable for you. So, did you have a specific knee problem?
No, I'm just asking in general.
Just in general? Okay, so you don't have bad knees, but just what if? Okay. To answer that question, proper shoes can help your knees to feel better. And an asterisk on can't, because you can still have sore knees even if you're wearing the best shoes for you. But at least it wouldn't have a contributing factor to making it feel worse. Anything that has to do with your anatomy, your shoes can make a big difference. And one of the things I always talk about is that sometimes people have old shoes that are kind of worn down, broken down, and they come in and want to get an arch support because they think it's going to make it feel better. And it's like putting a brand new house on an old foundation. It doesn't work very well because the house will just topple over when the foundation is bad. So it's not that we're just always trying to sell you shoes, but it makes sense, doesn't it? You need to have good pair of shoes that match the base of your foot and then get a complimentary insole or arch support or anything like that that could help you too. So be leery of that because you can maybe spend $50 on an insert, which actually I don't have any at $50, I mean $30 to $35, maybe $40 at the most, to get a good insert, and if you put it in a bad shoe, you may not notice the differences that you were hoping to attain at that point. So. That. I was going to mention something, I'm totally left.
Typically, you're supposed to look at like every 3 to 4 months to replace your shoes anyway, right?
Varies from person to person, okay? We're all different foot types, we're all different frame sizes. So, if you take one shoe that on an average will get you about 500 miles or 6 months to a year, that's what we tell everybody, because it varies. Small frame people might get longer out of it. Medium-sized people might be about the same. Large frame people might wear it out a little quicker. It's just the grim reality of if you're 150 pounds, 200 pounds, 250, wherever, you're going to, larger frame people will exert more pressure on it, you're gonna break it down sooner. Smaller frame people, they don't break it down as fast. So that's something to keep in mind. But average, 6 months to a year, 500 miles. So if you're keeping track of your steps or your mileage or those types of things, something to keep in mind. But we'll always have a record of when you purchased your shoes, so have an idea of how old they are, in case you ever want to do that. And some shoes like this, with the thicker soles, you can expect to get a little more time out of them because there's just more there and maintain its cushioning a little longer. The shoes that are the thinner soles that you asked about, lower profile, shouldn't expect to get as much time out of those because you can get shoes that have rock hard soles. You might see them in a work boot where they have a really hard Vibram soles and they're made to be ultra durable, but they're just not very comfortable and they're heavy. So if you have a need for cushioning and lightweight, that doesn't bode very well because it won't be comfortable, but they'll last forever, but you just wouldn't enjoy having the shoe. So it goes along with the territory. If the shoe's lighter, softer, faster, the downfall is that it's less durable. So you just can't expect to get as much time off when that's the case. But we have boots that if you need something like that, then we can do that. And they have a lot of comfort features too. Anything else on your mind? What's your
diet? If you switch between shoes, wear a different pair each day, you'll significantly increase the length of the shoe.
Okay.
Is that true? Like instead of just wearing it every day, wear it out after length, but have a day off.
Yeah, what that means, that's midsole recuperation. So basically, if you wear the same shoe every day, The midsole materials experience what's called compression setting. So they're made of a basic EVA foam. EVA is an acronym for ethyl vinyl acetate. It's been around forever, and they've just come up with different compounds of it for a long time, 40 years. So, scary part, 35 years since I've been doing this. Hold on. So anyway, what happens is with each step, and with each minute you're standing on them, you're breaking down the foam a little bit. But studies have shown that if you wear that shoe Monday and you put it aside Tuesday, you wear a different shoe Tuesday, then there have been some studies that say that you recoup 50% back what you expended on that day if you let them rest a day. So I always tell people, it's really up to you. You're going to go through two pairs of shoes in a year, whatever you do. So if you wear one shoe and just wear it straight through for 6 months, get a new one, or get two pair, wear them every other day for 6 months, it's a year. So it's still two pairs of shoes. But there's nothing wrong with doing it that way, because then you have a fresher shoe each day when you put it on, instead of one that you're just breaking down every day. Oh yeah, great question. Yeah. Anything else? No, nobody has sore feet or issues?
Foot cramps.
Oh. Okay, in the arch or in the ball of the foot, your toes? At the arch? Okay. And do you wear shoes like that most of the time?
No, I just blew out my shoes. So
oh, okay. Okay, all right. And do they cramp like at certain times or do they cramp all day long?
Once or twice a day.
Okay.
Usually once I relax.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
but it's bad enough cramp that you're hopping around on one foot and you're trying to rub it and get it out of there. Okay, well, it sounds like you probably benefit from wearing our supports, you know, and a better pair of shoes, probably. I don't know what you're wearing. Maybe you have a very good pair of shoes. So if you have a really good pair, I would suggest that maybe look into getting something to stabilize your fascia tendon, which is what connects the calcaneus to the metatarsals, so your heel bone to your forefoot bones. Because what's probably happening is this thing is getting overworked and exerted, and it's not supported. So every once in a while, it's probably just some tendonitis flashing up in there and creating a cramp. Yeah, but do some foot stretches. You know, like put your feet up against a wall or a curb or something. Get an inversion stretch going. That can help too. But maybe think about some arch supports. Anything else?
When your legs ache.
Okay. I'm glad you brought that up, because that's another thing I want to talk about, were socks. Okay. So, you know, that can be, aching legs can be a lot of things. It can be something systemic, and you may just have to change something in, what you're taking in for food, or getting hydrated properly enough, you know, those types of things. So that can make a difference. If your shoes aren't supportive enough, if you're not wearing arch supports, maybe try wearing compression socks that stimulate blood flow and provide extra support that way. Or maybe not compression socks, but compression sleeves. Compression therapy can be very helpful with that. Have you ever tried anything like that? You're wearing them right now. Okay. Now then the issue with the aching, you could be experiencing some lactic acid buildup. And I have sport supplements for that that are high doses, but they're elevated doses of magnesium and calcium. And that can help with the achiness or the heavy feeling that you may get there. So again, it's about shoes, arch supports, socks, and then whatever may be just in your system that might be causing that too. But briefly on socks, your socks, I'm giving away some featured socks. Anybody here own featured socks yet? Yeah, it's a fabulous sock. We have a real cult following with them. So they're, you know, your sock is what, when I say sock is what is directly next to your foot, so it needs to be efficient at a couple of things. You have 60,000 sweat glands in your feet, so they're going to perspire. So they need to be efficient at wicking perspiration away from your feet. So they should be made of hydrophobic materials to help to keep your foot dry. And they should be seamless, because seams across the toes, you know how uncomfortable that is. And if they're always ride them down, so they should fit your foot well and hug it and be relatively snug. Not uncomfortably tight, unless you're wearing a compression sock, but snug so they stay in place. And that's what those feature socks do, is they're just, it's just a wonderful product. They come in a variety of heights. I just brought some sport performance no-shows with TAP. But yeah, high thread count, anti-friction, anti-blister, hydrophobic materials that wick perspiration away, no seams, a banded arch to hold it in place, and just different weights for cushion and things like that. So keep in mind what your socks can do to make you more comfortable as well. Is there a lot of time used up soon?
Yeah. Did everybody put their name in for
men,
pair of socks?
For pair of socks? Men in the men's, women's in the women's?
I only see like four in the men's. I see more than four guys here. There are some socks, you guys.
Oh,
they're free.
I'll
We're just going to do a
one.
Drawing. Yeah. You don't have to buy them. They're yours.
Does everybody know where Kevin's store is at, you guys?
Yeah, I was going to bring that up.
Yeah, it's really important. I mean, I think the biggest thing is it shouldn't take 5 minutes to fit a pair of shoes. So if you aren't giving yourself more time than that, even for nothing else more than understand your body, you owe yourself a time to their store to really understand what's going on with your feet.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate that.
I'll vouch for you, too.
Yeah.
I've been there for 10 or 12 years.
Yep.
You guys do a wonderful job.
Yep. Yes. It can change your life. It really can, especially if you're a worker out or a runner on your feet all day.
Yeah, I mean, if your feet are miserable and your feet hurt when you're going to work, they hurt even worse when you get off work, or then you don't want to exercise, and then it's just a double-edged sword. You just, yeah, it affects your life, that's for sure. I mean, it's a big point. But anyway, we're on the corner of Highway 20 and Cedar Cross Road. If you know the vicinity there, there's the Olive Garden, the Hy-Vee gas station, sorry.
It's all right.
That's
when you get spit on your way by.
right across the street on the highway from Bird Chevrolet, Walgreens, at that intersection. So
it really is truly kind of down behind
yeah,
Hy-Vee,
right.
You guys. You gotta go down there. It's worth it. It is well worth it.
And
Dress shoes.
I can get dress shoes. I have a company called Aravon, which is. Well, they're now a division of Rockport. They used to be a division of New Balance, but they use athletic shoe technologies and put them into dressier shoes. So yes, I can get them, I don't stock them. And then I can also do orthopedic shoes. Anyone who has special needs, even if it's not you, but it's someone in your family. You know, we fit people with AFOs. Do you know what an AFO is? Ankle foot orthotic. It's a big plastic orthotic. They have to wear it. It's the difference between them walking or not. But they can't find shoes to fit them, so I can get shoes to fit those and help out with those things too. And then I fully train my staff, you know, and sometimes I have new people who are learning, and I have my daughter Renee has been with me for 15 years, and she knows how to do everything. So, but if I would ever fall below your expectations, just please need to let me know. Some people are learning the system, and they're not all perfect, but they're trying. So if there's something they can't answer, they'll defer to some of us that have been doing it much longer. But yeah, that's why I always offer you that 30-day comfort guarantee. In case we didn't get something quite right for you, we can fix it. But yeah, I'd love to help you out. I really appreciate your fixed attention. I hope that it was worth your while.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Very much so.
Yeah. Well, you're a wonderful audience. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.